Let's be honest with ourselves. By and large, especially in North America and Europe, other parts of the world, the church has not changed the world. The world has changed the church. Things that would have been abominable in the homes of our unsaved grandparents two generations ago are acceptable in the homes of believers today. Listen to me, friends. When we can distribute condoms in our public schools and not Bibles, it's time for a revolution. When a gay teacher in our schools, and I'm not saying this to bash gays, we love gay people and want to see them saved and set free the same way Jesus had mercy on us, we show love and compassion. But hear me. A gay teacher can get up in our schools and say, listen, I'm gay, and it's been very productive for me to come out of the closet, and you need to examine your own sexuality. They can be a math teacher and can talk like that. It's all right. Someone else stands up and says, you know, I was reading the Word of God. I'm a Christian, and the Scriptures changed my life. Do you know that that person can lose their job for it? He taught us to pray radical prayers like, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Out with this earthly, worldly, satanic kingdom, in with the kingdom of God. And he told his followers, leave everything and follow me. You know what that is? That's the talk of revolution. Jesus didn't come for a lovely religion. He came to launch God's revolution in the earth. The divorce rate in the church, I'm talking about the born again, even spirit-filled church, the divorce rate in the church is higher than the divorce rate among atheists. We need a revolution, friends. Something has to happen in our outlook, in our mentality. Something has to happen where we realize the reason that we are here is to glorify Jesus. The purpose in our lives is not what God can do for us. When you read the words of Jesus, you see that he did not come into this world to establish a lovely home and garden religion called Christianity. Okay? When you read his words, you don't find anything about Christmas or Easter. They may be fine, but you don't find anything about that. You don't find anything about church steeples. You don't find anything about denominations, even choir robes. Those things may be fine, but Jesus didn't talk about that. You know what he talked about? The kingdom of God. You know what he talked about? Setting captives free. You know what he talked about? Go and change the world. That's the Great Commission. Go and make disciples of the nations. He didn't just say go to church. He said go and change the world. And you know, the thing is, when you start to take hold of this, and you say, God put me in this world, whether it's marketplace ministry you're called to, whether you're called to be pouring into your kids, whether you're called to the mission field, whether you're called to preach behind a pulpit, when you take hold of this, God put me in this world to make a difference. There's a purpose. God's raised me up and saved me. And there is a divine purpose. And he's going to send me in this world to make a difference. We are here so that we can glorify Jesus. The normal commitment of a New Testament disciple is this. I will follow you by life or by death. Friends, we've got to get beyond the mentality of just going to church. A revolutionary thinks like this. Life as it is not worth living, but the cause is worth dying for. And if we live for Jesus. We love people, we honor people, we're respectful, but we do not bow down to the fear of man. We do not bow down to the praise of man. We don't live for a paycheck. We don't live for a degree. We don't live for the acclamation of the crowds. We live to glorify Jesus. If we can take hold of that, we can make a difference. You know why Stephen didn't back down before the Sanhedrin? You know why he didn't back down? Because he wasn't trying to save his life. He was trying to be a witness. And that's the mentality of a revolutionary. Jesus said, if you save your life, you lose it. If you lose your life for my sake and the gospel, you'll find it. Dr. Martin Luther King, 40 plus years ago, gave a speech. Because there was a lot of intimidation in the civil rights movement, and people were told, you know, if you stand up, there's going to be trouble. You can lose your job. You may get beaten. They may send the police dogs on you, and people were getting hurt, and they were backing away, and they were afraid of moving forward. You know what Dr. King said? A man dies when he refuses to stand up for that which is right. A man dies when he refuses to stand up for that which is true. Jesus said, if you save your life, you lose. If you live for this world, for the praise of men, for the adoration of men, for the love of the gods of this world, you lose it. You have nothing. When you begin to take hold of that, I tell you, something revolutionary happens in your own life. I wonder those watching, are you free? Are you free to do the will of God? Have you made the commitment? The purpose of my life is to glorify Jesus. The purpose of my life is to bear fruit. The purpose of my life is to make an impact. And if I have a job, if I have a family, if I have a career, if I have a public face, if I have a private face, doesn't matter. I'm going to glorify Jesus. When you do that, you're free. When you lose it for Jesus' sake, then you really live. Now you're free to do the will of God. I believe the next wave that's coming is going to take the power of a fresh wave of revival and the militancy of a revolution, and it's going to shake this nation. I believe it's going to shake nations of the world. I believe God's going to be mightily glorified. I just turned 50, and I was telling the Lord, you know, I've seen amazing things happen. I've seen wonderful things happen. But I started crying. I said, God, if the best years of my life were behind me, that's an absolute tragedy. That would be an unspeakable tragedy. If I just look back to the great things you did in the past, there must be more. And I tell you, to the degree of your hunger and your thirst and your desire, God himself will fill you. Just raise your hands to God right now and say, God, fill me afresh. Fill me afresh. Fill me afresh. It's time. It's time.
Yes,
it's time.
Yes, Lord.
Fill me afresh, Lord.